Hi! In this video, I'll open up four decoration lasers and see what's inside. How do they work? How powerful are they? I will measure them with a laser power meter since I have a feeling they are way beyond the power indicated on their labels. Wear laser safety goggles when messing around with powerful lasers and do not open them unless you know what you are doing. These decoration lasers can be used for a lot of things, but they are intended to be placed in a garden and project green and red dots onto your house at night, typically around Christmas, where it is popular to have houses illuminated with a lot of lights. I have never used mine for the intended purpose though. I have just bought these over the years, after Christmas, where they were on sale, often for 50% off. I like lasers, and these are special since they run on mains electricity, are remote controlled and designed to work in a very wide temperature range for hours upon hours, without overheating, unlike most laser pointers. They can also be set to blink, light only one laser, and three of them even have motion built in, making for a lot of different light functions. Well, in one of them, the motion function is not working, so I'll try to fix that when I open it. The two with a working motion function have quite different speeds. One is slow and one is fast. I prefer the slow moving one. Let me know in a comment which speed you prefer. The four lasers can be divided into two types. The ones with a single aperture for both the red and the green laser, and the ones with dual apertures, one for each laser color. Let's open them up and see the differences inside. I will start with the simplest and smallest one, a dual aperture type with no motion. There we have it, the green laser on the left and the red laser on the right. And some double axis diffraction gratings in front of them to split the beam into hundreds of beams. The main part of the enclosure is all metal, working as a giant heatsink for the two lasers. The back is made of plastic. There's a reason for this, as we'll soon see. There's an antenna inside for the radio frequency remote control. The plastic lets the radio signal pass through, metal wouldn't. The crystal oscillator is marked 6.7458 MHz, which is the reference clock speed used in 433 MHz remote controls. Worth noticing too is the unused third pin on the green laser. It reveals they did not decide to use a photodiode as feedback on how the laser performs. They are, however, sensoring something near the green laser, most likely the temperature, to make sure the green laser is not overheating when turned on for hours. Other than that, there's not much of interest. There is a connection for a motor, but they did not implement the motion function in this laser. It is, however, clearly the brightest of the four lasers. Maybe because the extra optics for the motion function lowers the output. Maybe because they put stronger lasers in it. We will know when I test them on a laser power meter later. Let's move on to some that do have the motion function. The two single aperture models look very similar on the outside and have similar functions. Except the black one does not have remote control and the motion function seems broken. If I open the working one first, I may be able to figure out how to fix the broken one. It does seem to have a second aperture. It is just taped over. This looks way more interesting than the first laser. There's a big heatsink for the green laser and a motor with a gearing house in front of the lasers. The laser beams are sent through the same aperture using a technique from real show lasers. The green laser beam passes through a dichroic mirror that is transparent to green, but it reflects the red laser light. Nice detail in such a cheap laser. The motor is spinning a diffraction grating. This makes the beam spin before they are sent through a second static diffraction grating sitting in the aperture. A simple setup giving the nice motion effect. In the heatsink I spot a temperature sensor again. It is marked NTC on the PCB, revealing the use an NTC thermistor. But I also spot something else with much thicker wires sitting in the heatsink, marked RES. This confused me until I realized thicker wires are used for something that draws a lot of current, a heating element. Yep, inside the heatsink, meant for cooling the green laser, they put a heating element to warm it up. Seems illogical until you remember these lasers are designed to work outside in a cold winter. And if you have seen my video, Lasers Drift with Temperature, where I put a green laser pointer in the freezer and test it, you know they do not like freezing temperatures. So they need to heat up the green laser in cold weather, which can take some time. On the PCB, I notice the antenna for the remote control and a missing connection. It has something to do with the second aperture, as we'll see in the next laser. Will this be exactly the same inside? No, there are differences. It also has the second aperture taped over, inside the glass. Which is odd, since this one has a light sensor, a photodiode for turning the laser off in daylight. Except the sensor will never see daylight with tape in front of it. Digging deeper, I immediately spot the problem with the motion function. There's no diffraction grating on the spinning cylinder. The grating has come loose. Unlike the other one, they only glued this one, and not very well. At least it is an easy fix for later. Alright, time to open the last one. It is bigger and more solidly built, but has the same elements as the other ones. Gives me a chance to rest my winter sore throat. Cue the music. Now, thanks to the help from my patrons, we will test the laser's power output on a laser power meter. First, on the collimated laser beams, which is easy on the one missing a diffraction grating. However, the light sensor is a good safety feature when the laser is opened. It will not turn on until I tape over the sensor. I will start with the red laser. Let's see if it's under 1 milliwatt. No, 28 milliwatts on the red alone. How about the green laser? 24 milliwatts. Seems high to me for a class 2 labeled laser, but on the other hand, this is with the laser disassembled. I will measure the output at the aperture after I have fixed the motion function. Thank you. It is no longer one collimated beam after the diffraction gratings. But with 26 milliwatts, I can't help but think that up close an eye would collect and focus way more than 1 milliwatt. Do not stare into these lasers at close range. Here are the measurements for the other lasers. Ready to see the power from the brightest one. They surely did use stronger lasers in this one. A milliwatt screen is enough for a visible beam. As with many laser pointers, the conclusion is once again, do not judge a laser by its label. Always expect lasers to be a risk for the eyes. Thanks to all my patrons. Creators like me aren't always praised here on the internet, but at least I have your fantastic support. Thank you very much. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.